8, the Honourable Member for Beltsy-Mastino-O'Shea. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Climate change is an extremely serious global threat for our environment, our economy, and our lives. While employment and the environment are part of the main priorities of Canadian families, the Conservative government continues to ignore the will of citizens and shows once again that it is completely disconnected from reality. Here are the impacts of climate change in Canada. A report from September 2011, published by the Environment and Economy Roundtable, estimates that the cost of climate change for Canada could be in the neighborhood of $5 billion per year as of 2020 and could continue to climb to between $21 and $43 billion per year as of 2050. In addition, since 1948, the average temperature in Canada has increased by 1.3 degrees Celsius. A 1 meter rise in sea levels would cause flooding of over 15,000 hectares of industrial and residential land, and over 4,600 hectares of farmland, as well as the flooding of the Vancouver International Airport. Insurance payments in Quebec for claims linked to storm surges and sewer backups in 2005-2006 represent an increase of 25% over the payments made in 2001-2002. All of these are facts that we must not ignore. We must act in environmental matters. Each gesture can make a difference. We must work together. The NDP has a vision of a Canada that invests in future generations, in clean energy jobs, and that adopts an international leadership position in the fight against climate change and in the creation of a new energy economy. We must think of future generations. I'm thinking of my young son, and it has to start today. Our children have the right to hope for a better quality of life. And that will depend on the choices that we make today concerning the environment. Several environmental disasters have shown us clearly that the climate is warming and that we must act. Instead, the government is trying to make the Kyoto Protocol a failure. Climate change imposes risk for health and personal safety. Forests, wildlife, farms, and water, and that is why we need to take concrete measures to stop it.
That is the case here and elsewhere, and Quebec is facing climate change. For example, in 2011, there was flooding in the Richelieu area. Record snowfall in the Lac Champlain area, and an exceptional amount of rain in the Montérégie in the spring were responsible for this historic flooding in the spring of 2011. This natural disaster affected 3,000 homes in the region, and people are still facing consequences of that today. During the winter of 2010-2011, the ice on the St. Lawrence in the Gulf of the St. Lawrence didn't form. And as a result, there was an impact for economic and tourist-based activities. Those are two examples of climate change on our environment. But we know that all of these kinds of disasters occur throughout the world. It's false to think that we can't make changes with respect to the environment and climate change. And it's even worse to ignore the alarm signals. Mr. Speaker, my colleagues and I urge the House to play a leadership role in tackling global climate change and ensuring Canadian jobs aren't lost. We What we want is a fair agreement, a binding agreement. We want adequate funding for green funds. And we want to reduce the gigaton gap between emissions. And we want legally binding commitments. Mr. Speaker, the current situation is hindering Canada's image worldwide. The NDP wants action on climate change. Developing countries must reflect or take care of their share of emissions. And as a result, we need to adopt and meet targets. There needs to be a combined effort of 40% reductions by 2020 as compared to levels in 1990. We are calling for ambitious measures by all countries, including Canada. Canada must make a second round of commitments as part of the during the second implementation phase of the Kyoto Protocol or as part of an alternative treaty in the event that countries decide to abandon Kyoto. Canada must honor its commitments made during the first round. We need to honor these commitments for young people. And I think about my young son. In the past, there was a great deal of snow. We don't see that today. Some species of animals are dying throughout the world. We need to work together for our young people. We need to come up with solutions together for future generations. Therefore, I urge my colleagues opposite to work with us because we have solutions to propose. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Questions and comments? The Honourable Member for Langley.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I listened intently, and I want to thank the member for this her comments on this very important issue. She said she wants action, and of course she is seeing action. Does she disagree with the action that the government has taken, specifically in regard to asking all major emitters to sign on to a new international agreement that will truly reduce greenhouse gas emissions? We know that with Bill C-469, the NDP bill in the last parliament, it did not want to have the major emitters participating in a new international agreement. Is that, have they changed now, or do they want to continue on with only 27% of greenhouse gas emissions? May I continue? Thank you. So the question is, does the member prefer the 27% of global greenhouse gas emissions or 85%? Second question, does she support the carbon tax that her party supports?
L'honorable député.
The honorable member for Berthier-Masquinongé. We support a carbon tax, and personally, I feel that it's important to work with other countries. We need to sit down at the table and focus on these issues. We cannot abandon the Kyoto Protocol. We need to work together. We're speaking about the future of our children and the future for their children. It is important for me and my party to be leaders, to show leadership, and that is what we're proposing.
Questions and comments? The Honourable Member for Kingston and the Islands.
Mr. Speaker, I find it a little bit strange that the member opposite seems to be claiming that Canada is showing leadership in another direction other than Kyoto. I'd like to ask my honourable colleague over here whether she thinks that Canada is really trying to do something significant as an alternative to Kyoto if it's receiving these fossil awards at the conference in Durban. Whether the international community would agree with that assessment.
L'honorable député de Berthier-Masquinongé.
The honourable member for Berthier-Masquinongé, and I'd like to thank my colleague for his question. With the three fossil prizes, That, in and of itself, is proof. The government's plan, the Hartford government's plan, isn't enough. We're being ridiculed on the world stage. We need instead to take a leadership role, and we need to work together. I want the party opposite to listen. Questions and comments, the Honourable Member for Abitibi-Témiscamingue. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. In my colleague's remarks, so she mentioned her son on many occasions. And thanks to her son, she has access to the new generation, to friends in his classes, to what young people are thinking these days. I'd like to know whether she has seen, whether young people are concerned about these issues. How do young people see these issues? The Honourable Member for Berthier-Masquinongeais, and I thank you, Mr. Speaker. Young people are very involved. They are very aware of climate change and know that it's a problem. And they're taking steps in their schools. I know that my son, when I make his lunch, I do so. I put it in recyclable containers. They're thinking of the future. This is an example of what the steps they're taking for the environment in schools. And play a role, a leadership role. Future generations are involved. That's why here, and that's why we need to display leadership.
Resuming debate.